Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel, welcome back to another video, and today I'm doing my January reading wrap-up. So January 2021 started out really incredible, actually. I read 12 books, about half of them are manga though, so I kind of just like mushing those together, but honestly I don't think I could have asked for a better year. Some of these books were incredible. Some of them made it to my favorites list, so let's kind of just jump right into it. And we're going to start with my most disappointing or probably like least favorite book that I read, and that would be the Dean Angel series. I'll put it on this way, you can cover up Nova. Hi Nova. So I read the Dean Angel series, the first four volumes. I haven't read this since I was probably in middle school, so like almost 15 years ago. So the quick synopsis of this is the main character, Daisuke Niwa here, on his 14th birthday, he confesses his love to his love interest at the time, and she rejects him, and it's on his birthday, poor guy. But we also kind of learn that he sort of has been trained or raised to be able to do suspiciously suspicious things, like he can hack locks and keypads and acrobatically dodge dangerous traps. And then on his birthday, he figures out that his bloodline actually allows him to transform into the Phantom Thief Dark. And Dark is a separate entity from himself, so they kind of like talk to each other, like in his head. But he will actually transform into him, and this is actually Dark here. And so whenever they transform, they actually like look different and stuff like that. And he transforms anytime he thinks about like feelings of love or whatever. So it's kind of like the gimmick of like anytime they need him to transform, his mother will like show him a picture of his love interest, whose name is Risa, and we'll get to her soon. And then whenever he like feels those like emotions, he will transform. And so pretty much that's the plot of the story, is that by night he is Dark, or Dark takes over, and they like goad the police and leave notes, and they steal artifacts from like museums and stuff like that. And then by day, Daisuke has to deal with his feelings and his secret identity. So what I really liked about this book obviously was the premise. I'm really interested in art myself, and so I like the idea of them like going around stealing art and being like an art thief. Some of the artifacts do have magical properties, but they really don't go into it that much. The main character I think is actually pretty adorable and innocent, Daisuke. And what I actually really like and appreciate is that the artist, or like the author, she does a lot kind of with fashion, so like they're always wearing different clothes, and she kind of puts an emphasis on them like looking cool and stuff like that. So it's just something I appreciated when I was growing up. Most animes or cartoons, they're always wearing the same clothes, and I kind of like them changing it up. Unfortunately though, this series did not hold up at all. It did not age well. Two primary things is, one being that they thought that sexual harassment was a cute look, and it didn't work. There were some like major instances of them doing weird things that was definitely sexual harassment or inappropriate, and they kind of played off like it was cute or whatever, and I didn't like that. It didn't age well at all. And the second was the main interest, Risa. She's incredibly annoying, and she doesn't understand like friend zoning, and kind of just leads Daisuke along, and we don't really see them being friends like before any of this really happens. It's not like they've been friends for a while and all of a sudden Daisuke like admits he likes her. In fact, they don't seem like they're really friends at all. So that's whatever. She's really annoying, but she does have a sister, Riku, who is a lot better. Anyway, so I'm not gonna wrap this up a bit really quickly. The second one was probably the worst. I think almost every chapter in this volume has Risa in it, and she's incredibly annoying. And then chapter 3 starts to get a lot better, and we start getting a lot more like groundwork and like lore kind of built up to the series. And then book 4 was probably my favorite. It has Daisuke getting a new love interest, so by Risa, and introduces like a new antagonist and stuff like that. So not a super great start, but I do still have the next 4 volumes. I'm gonna read those in February, and if it ends up not getting any better, then just gonna cut my losses. Now, my opposite feelings to that is actually Full Metal Alchemist. I read 2, 3, and 4 this month. I read the first one sometime last year. So this is definitely a really popular series. I also have the really nice Full Metal editions, which I love. And this is about two brothers, one being Edward, the other one being Alphonse. And they end up losing their body in an alchemical accident. And Alphonse loses his entire body. That's why he's in a suit of armor. And Edward loses his leg and then sacrifices his arm to save Al's soul and put it in the suit of armor. After that, Edward becomes a state alchemist so that they can get the Philosopher's Stone, which is this fabled object that should help them restore their bodies. But it's also, they don't even know if it's real or anything. But they end up kind of revealing this like more dangerous plot. It's crazy, but it's also amazing. I've watched the show before, but I've never watched the manga, so I'm really looking forward to reading the rest of it. Like I said, these were like all 5 stars. I'm loving it so far. Best part about it is definitely the characters. There's the 2 main characters are incredible, but every character they bring in after that is also done really well. I also really enjoy the humor of it. So the way they do like the panels are really well done. It's all really nice clean art in the background, or anytime there's like funny or humorous parts, it's all really done. I'm like always like laughing at these, and I usually don't laugh when I read something, so it's a nice change of pace. Not that I don't think things are funny, but it's really rare that you actually laugh out loud when you're reading something. It's not as common like in like shows and stuff like that. So the first novel I ended up reading this year is Trials of Apollo by Rick Riordan. This is the 5th and final book in the Trials of Apollo series. So it's kind of hard to explain this if you don't already know what it is or have read the... because this is actually a spinoff series of 2 other series. So if you haven't read those, you're not going on too much about this. But basically, after the Heroes of Olympus series, Zeus, Apollo's father, punishes him by sending him to Earth as a mortal to basically go on a bunch of quests to clean up his mistakes. So I really like the way this ended. This whole series is basically just Riordan like maturing and growing with his audience, and it really proves in these books, especially this final one. And I actually have a full like series review and discussion on my channel, so I'll link that if you're interested in my more thoughts about it. So after that, I read Fireborn by Rosaria Munda. This came highly recommended by Elliot Brooks, and honestly, it didn't disappoint like at all. Like I really liked it. It actually ended up being one of my favorite books, or it's like on my list of like favorite books now. This story is about 2 characters, Lee and Annie. They basically both grew up as orphans, but they are kind of conflicting sides. So Lee is actually the last heir to the throne that the rebellion sort of overthrew, because right now we're in a time period after this rebellion kind of like killed the previous leaders, and Lee is the son of one of those leaders. And then Annie's family was killed by Lee's father. But they don't really admit that to each other, even though it's implied that they kind of know. But yeah, this book was incredible. It has a lot of really great character moments. The characters are really deep, really complex, and compelling. It actually makes a love square work, which I don't know how, because I really hate moments like those. But it really works in this one because it's not super dramatic. It doesn't really take over the plot. And honestly, each of the 4 people that are involved in it all have their own really great chemistry with each other and compatibility, so it works. But yeah, the stakes are incredibly high in this, like they just keep ramping up, and I really don't know how the characters are ever going to solve it or get through it. So it was a wild ride, and I really liked it. 5 stars for sure. The book I read after that is Light of the Jedi. This is the first book in the like High Republic like campaign that Disney's doing. I'm actually gonna have a full review, I have like a full dedicated review to Fireborn, which I almost never do. It's actually kind of funny that some of these have a dedicated review. I usually don't do dedicated reviews. I don't have time. Like, it takes me forever to read a book and takes me too long to record the review. So I usually don't get a chance to do a lot of dedicated reviews. But I have one for Fireborn, and I'm going to have one for Light of the Jedi. That's coming up soon. So anyways, Light of the Jedi, like it says, the first book in the High Republic campaign. This is set like 300 years before the 4th movie, if you're a Star Wars fan. And this starts off really impactful. So there's a lot of intense stakes, and you can tell there are consequences, but it doesn't really let you get too attached to anyone at first. I feel like you're kind of slowly working up to that. That's all the first part. And then after the first part, you really start to kind of get like more smaller stories and kind of get more introduced to certain characters. I really liked it. I think it was a really excellent start. I did enjoy the way they actually did the Jedi. I think it did a really good job of making you feel the hope that characters feel whenever the Jedi show up, because that's literally what the Jedi are supposed to embody, is hope. And I think it did a really good job of portraying that. I also think in general the way that it handled the Force, like how it has each Jedi sort of see it differently, whether they see the Force as like a fire or music or the ocean or something like that. It was just really well written. So as much as I like this book, I am, however, hesitant on how they're going to continue it. Yeah, like I said, just watch the video I'm going to post in like a week or so, because it has my full thoughts and my hesitations about this. And the next book I read is Crooked Kingdom by Leigh Bardugo. This is the second book in the Six of Crows duology. And this was incredible. If you haven't already seen Read with Cindy's like gush about it, I would just watch that, because she essentially just embodied my emotions during that whole thing. This actually had a unique effect on me, to where normally if I like the first book and then the second one's even better, it makes the first one seem not as good. But this had the opposite effect, because the first one I was like, it was okay. I liked it. It was good. A lot better than I thought. And the second one was so amazing that, like, this is definitely one of my favorite books now. It's, like, going on the list right next to Fireborn. And honestly, the first one even seems better in hindsight now, like, because you need both of them, obviously, for this one to be so great. But this continued to develop the characters. The plot was very fast and well-paced, and there's more character development and emotions. And I was just like, like, I honestly can't believe how much I ended up liking this book. I liked it so much, in fact, that I ended up buying King of Scars, because I know Nina is one of the perspectives in it. And actually, I'll talk about King of Scars just a little bit later. But yeah, for now, I'm done with this one. It was incredible. I really liked it. The last book that I read in January was Peter Pan, like the original classic by J.M. Barrie. I originally was going to read Peter and the Star Catchers. That was the book that I had planned to read in January. But I saw Murphy Napier's very emotional kind of like review. She did a whole video on why she loves Peter Pan, because she talks about it a lot. So I thought, hey, let me pick up the classic before I get to the Peter and the Star Catchers. Because I have this edition, which is really nice. And I've had it for a while because I really like Peter Pan. When I was younger, I really liked the story of Peter Pan. I feel like I related to it a lot as a boy growing up who's very imaginative and adventurous. And as I got a little bit older, I always felt myself thinking back to when I was a kid. I think like most people do. And honestly, I really like my life now, but... And I really like my life now, but, I mean, you always kind of think about being a kid again. It's just a simpler time, a lot more fun, you know. Anyways, that was a brief explanation of why I even bought Peter Pan, even though I've actually never read it. It's like kind of like the general story of it. I like the retellings. Like I said, this is actually a reread for me. I really liked this series. I wanted to give it another read. I was inspired by Murphy's emotional video to try reading the classic before I went and picked up any of these. And honestly, my initial reactions, I wish I didn't. Like, I wish I didn't read this novel. It wasn't all bad. I gave it like 3 stars. But I kind of wish I just stayed ignorant of how much I didn't realize. I didn't realize how sad this book was, honestly. Like, this book is actually pretty sad for me. I felt it was very bittersweet. There's obviously a lot of issues, like race. And then, honestly, even genders. And I feel like mostly it should probably be more offensive for women, because it puts them in, like, the role that women are trying to not be stereotyped into, which is being like a mother and just like a housemaid and stuff like that. But honestly, the guys didn't look too good in this either. Like, I feel like both genders have a reason to be offended by this. But even besides all of that stuff, just in general, like, Peter's really sad. Like, if you don't really know, and maybe it's supposed to be this way, or maybe I'm just kind of like my perception of it, but to me it basically feels like Peter died. It's like Peter lost his mother and probably died, and now he's sort of like whimsically lives in this other place where he doesn't grow up or anything like that, and he rescues other lost boys, other people who have lost their parents. Specifically, they just keep talking about mothers. I really hope that the word is interchangeable and they just mean like parental caregiver, because the fathers don't look too good in this book at all. Peter is just stuck in this body of always being like a selfish kid, and yeah, he's fun, he's like a good time and everything, but he's also really forgetful. So like the entire time I feel this loneliness come from him, because I know that eventually everyone's gonna go back home and he's not gonna go with them. And obviously he kind of forgets, so he probably doesn't care, but also talks about how he like cries at night to these nightmares and Wendy like holds him. So yeah, he's just like really tragic. Like I'm just like really sad by it. I mean, even it goes so far as to him like forgetting Tinkerbell. Like I didn't expect that. First off, I didn't like Tinkerbell at all in this book. If it wasn't for like Disney and like Julia Roberts and Hook, I don't think anybody would like Tinkerbell because she's terrible in this book. Except for the fact that she saves Peter for like that 1 second. But yeah, Tink is awful. And even then, whenever they like unceremoniously kill her off, I was still like, what? Because at the very end, like Wendy meets back up with Peter and she's like, oh, I hope Tinkerbell likes me. And then he's like, who is Tinkerbell? And Wendy's like, the fairy. And Peter's like, oh yeah, she's probably dead because they have short lives. Oh well, let's move on. I was just like, what? Whatever. So yeah, it was enjoyable because it was fun and whimsical, but the entire time I just had that feeling of sadness. I don't know. For me, I like all the retellings. I'm nervous to even rewatch the Disney movie because I don't remember if it's going to hold up or not. But I prefer the happier retellings. I also know there's like a lot of negative retellings of Peter Pan. Like usually he's like the villain, which I can see. I mean, the whole thing is him being really selfish because he's supposed to be a kid and he's like a wild child, but still like the more positive portrayals of Peter. This was actually the first classic I've picked up in probably since high school, and it actually inspired me to want to read Treasure Island. This is another book that I had just laying around. I have this like really nice like leather bound edition. I think I probably got it because I really like the Disney version of this, which is Treasure Planet. I don't know how much they relate. I know I would still love Treasure Planet. That's such a good movie. But I figured I'd probably go ahead and read this at some point. Hopefully it doesn't make me as sad as Peter Pan. But yeah, that is it. These are all the books that I have read. And oh no, the book is upside down. No! It's ruining my picture. This is my first official on-camera stack reveal. I can't mess this up. This whole thing is going to be a mess. Probably going to cut all this mumbling out. Ooh, okay. Now the right side up? Yes. So this is my full January wrap-up. All the books that I read in January. So really good, like I said. I couldn't have really, like, asked for like a better reading month. This was like so incredible. I'm really happy with all these books because honestly I feel like I just did my favorite books of 2020 like not too long ago, and I already imagine a lot of these books ending up on that list for 2021, and hopefully you know throughout the year they won't be alone. I'll pick up some more. So this is normally where I say goodbye, but actually I have more. That's right, this video has twists. Some of my previous videos, I talk a lot about how I used to read the first chapter of every book that I bought because I used to buy a lot of books and just sort of put them on my shelf. But I kind of wanted to develop some form of an attempt at holding myself accountable. So I wanted to read the first chapter of every book. That way I felt like I've consumed part of it. And also it kind of will help me gauge if I'm liking it or not. Like for instance, when I did this with the Red, White, and Royal Blue back in 2019, I loved it so much, I like immediately added to my TBR and read it that month. It ended up becoming one of my favorite books. My point is, I'm actually gonna try doing that again this year, and I thought that I'd probably put these at the end of my monthly wrap-ups. That way that's kind of like a mini haul, and then also I can kind of talk a little bit about the books. So I'm just gonna discuss like the brief first chapters, and then I don't feel like that's too bad of an idea, because honestly, even sometimes when people go to the bookstore, they always read the first chapter of a book to see if they're interested. So I'm actually going to get those out of the way first, the books that I read and were not super interested in. The first one being Sufficiently Advanced Magic by Andrew Rowe, or Rao. I mean, this was, for the most part, insanely popular. People really end up liking this. I'm quite familiar, actually, with the synopsis because it's pretty straightforward. The main character tries to complete this Tower of Challenges so that he can get enough power to rescue his brother, who also went into this tower but never came back. And that's essentially what the story's about that I know of. The first chapter was okay. I mean, it jumps right into it. He immediately enters the tower. We immediately see his competence and him solving puzzles and stuff like that. I mean, it felt like you were kind of just reading like a D&D story, which I think is something is talked about. It kind of reads like an RPG or something like that. So it was fine. It's just nothing about it really stood out to me. It wouldn't be one where I would like immediately like be like, wow, I have to keep reading this right now. It's also really big. So that doesn't help if you the first chapter doesn't really capture you and you think like, okay, I've got a lot more to go. The book after that, which is a little disappointing, is Persephone Station by Stina Licht. This definitely made its rounds on BookTube this month with everyone talking about all the books that are coming out for 2021 and looking forward to. I was also looking forward to this one. I love this cover, which, by the way, if you don't know, the artist is the same one who did the Lunar Chronicles, like, remake, all, like, post pictures. Those covers are really cool. I actually want to read the series just for those covers, but I have the first one, not the new cover, but I have the first Lunar Chronicle book of the old cover, and I haven't even picked it up yet, so I should probably get to that one before I buy a whole series. Anyways, so this story I don't really know too much about besides the fact that it's like a mix of Cowboy Bebop and The Mandalorian. It's a FM, like, sapphic romance. It's like a space opera. It's like set in space. It's a sci-fi novel. And the first chapter was all about these aliens who are being mistreated by humans because we're terrible. And then destruction strikes. And then a plot device put in at the very end of the chapter. One of the aliens ends up like spilling something on a human that's essentially this chemical that seems to be dangerous or sets up something dangerous. I don't know. But the characters in the first chapter aren't in the synopsis or in like the blurb or anything. So I don't know who they are or what the first chapter was. It was just kind of weird. It just didn't like put me in the mood to like want to keep reading. Like, I'm sure I'm still gonna get to it. I'm sure it's more interesting than the first chapter. But hey, I'm not judging the book by the cover, just by the first chapter, which I feel like is warranted. The book I read after that, or chapter, is The Ninth Rain, also highly praised by Elliot Brooks. She talked a lot about this last year. Which is ironic because I don't know what it's about, even though she talked about it a lot. But I feel like she even admitted that it has a lot going on. It apparently pulls from a lot of different things, like it's a fantasy, but there's like an alien invasion and stuff like that. I don't know. The first chapter is really interesting. If you find human sacrifices to a dead tree god interesting, that then you'll like this first chapter. The book I read after that is Bedazzled by Ryan LaSala. This is a MM romance, and it's essentially about a boy who likes to do cosplay, and his ex-boyfriend also likes cosplay, but they're now exes, which is sad. But essentially the first chapter is just him being pretty quirky, really kind of us getting to know his personality. He has a mother who's also an artist, but she looks down upon almost every other art except for hers, which I can completely relate to as someone who went to art school. That's literally what all the teachers kind of acted like, is that you were supposed to be doing art that belongs in a museum, and that wasn't really me at all. So I relate to his struggle. But then at the very end, his ex-boyfriend walks in with the costume that he originally gave the idea for, or the main character originally gave the idea for this costume, and his ex-boyfriend walks in with it, and that's dramatic. That's how the first chapter ends. So that seems like really fun. It's a contemporary. I usually get through those really quickly. Another book, also by Ryan LaSala, is Reverie, which came highly praised from my friend Isaac over at Books with Ike. He highly recommended this book. Very mysterious and really intense, apparently. I mean, the first chapter is, we're aware of the main character who did something illegal and traumatic, but he doesn't remember it. So we don't know if he's guilty or being framed or whatnot. I don't know, but it's really interesting and mysterious, and I'm curious. And it also introduces his sister, who seems to really care about him, so it's nice to have like a familial bond like right at the beginning. So that one's also high on my list. And lastly is King of Scars by Leigh Bardugo. See, I told you it was gonna come back. So I actually don't really know what this is about, except that it's one of the main point of views is Nina from Six of Crows duology. And the other one is Nikolai, who's the prince or king or whatever. He was in the original Grisha trilogy, which I have not read and I won't read, but I did spend the whole week reading spoilers, so I know what's going on now. Sorry if that kind of offends you, but like the Grisha trilogy just isn't for me. I don't imagine myself liking it very much. I mean, like, even when I read the plot, I was still like, okay, this is an okay plot, but I'm really aware of like how the writing goes and how the characters interact and stuff like that. I mean, I think they're one of the main characters that talks about, like, the love interest. Not Nikolai, but the other love interest. Everyone talks about how annoying and terrible he is. But the way that the spoilers were talking about. It all seems logical and sensible, but it's how you're getting that information that makes it so not fun to read. So I can just tell I'm not going to read it. I feel like I have all I need to know to read King of Scars. So hopefully it goes well. I know the plot, so I should be okay with it. In fact, I liked it so much, I'm actually putting it on my like immediate TBR. Like, I'm actually going to read this February. I'm really looking forward to it. The first chapter was really atmospheric and very subverting, and it has me intrigued. And yeah, I just immediately put on my February book list. I'm definitely going to read it next month. Which, speaking of which, is going to be my next video, of course. That's how that's how these videos usually go. If you've seen any of my old ones, you know that I usually put them together. But that's usually because they're shorter. And I obviously had a lot of content for this video, and this video is probably already long enough. But yeah, let me know what you thought about any of these books that I've read. And if you've read any of the books that I talked about at the end, where I've only read the first chapter, let me know if any of them should be higher or lower on my TBR. You can always join me on Goodreads or Instagram for more bookish communications. But that's going to be it for me, guys. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you all next time. Bye now.